American University in Bulgaria.
We can continue with the lecture from this morning. For newcomers, I'm happy to introduce Rado Nikolov, who is the Chief Technical Officer of Transmetrics. And he will continue his presentations on solving logistic problems.
Okay, so as I mentioned in the morning, the problem we are trying to solve is to predict future volume of shipments. By future, I mean next week, or actually we started with next 6 weeks, but then limited ourselves to just next week. The idea of predicting this is that trucks are often empty or half empty, and knowing in advance how much empty capacity, or we're trying to predict what the demand will be next week, but you can derive the empty capacity, and knowing in advance how much empty capacity there will be next week, a company could either sell this capacity to other companies or even optimize it within the company by just using other products. As I mentioned, a transport company usually have offer different products with different service agreements, and they could be somehow consolidated and transported together. But the main reason for this not happening is that companies do not know the exact volume until the very last moment, and at that time, it is very hard to react. You have to know in advance in order to do all the logistic and management of the shipments. So we started trying to predict the exact volume for the next week, actually for the days of the next week, with the assumption there was obviously we would not be able to just to predict one number and that's it, but we expected that we would be able to predict, to have this point estimate with quite a narrow confidence interval, so that you can have it as a kind of point estimation. However, it appeared, as you saw in the morning, that the problem was quite hard. We are missing lots of data. The data that we had was not looking like something that is easy to model and predict, and so on. So we decided to see what else could be estimated, even if we're unable to predict, but still allow to somehow optimize the volumes. So we started thinking betting. What's the common with betting? Okay, you don't know how much volume will be next week, but you could bet that there will be, for example, 5 tons or 10 tons or something like that. And when you bet, consider an unfair coin. You don't know the outcome, but if you know that the expected outcome is positive, you would expect that in long term you'll be profitable. Maybe this is better. However, even if you don't know the outcome, how much you bet depends on what odds are on your side. So you would bet differently if there are 37. Okay, this is a negative outcome, so you should not play this game. This is even, so there's no reason to play it. But in this case, you have a positive outcome. Still, you would bet differently in either case. And this is how we started thinking. What should we know for the future volume if we don't know how much it is, so that we can bet somehow optimally. I mean, by optimally, I mean try to minimize losses and at the same time get some profits. By the way, if you're curious about this betting, in this particular case, and not only in this particular case, the classical betting, how to say it, the classical problem here is how to bet so that you maximize the profit and at the same time you never default. And there's something called Kelly criterion. John Kelly, an engineer from Bell Labs, get this maybe 50 years ago, and it was used by Claude Shannon and Edward Thorpe. These are, you might know who Claude Shannon is, and Edward Thorpe is a mathematician, one of the first that actually beat the dealer in Las Vegas. He wrote the book Beat the Dealer, that was about blackjack, and later the book Beat the Market, that was about stock market. So there is very interesting story about this Kelly criterion. You can, there is a book, Fortune Formula, I think is called, that is quite interesting. So if you ever want to become a professional pocket poker player or start investing in stock market, it is good to research this. But the idea here for this Kelly criterion in this particular case is quite simple. I mean, you can have you have to maximize the profit, and you get a geometric progression that you want to maximize. You just need to find the fraction of your wealth that you have to bet on each term. Anyway, the idea is that we decided to bet, and for betting you don't need to know the, you need to know the mean, but you also need to, the shape of the distribution. That's the idea. But let's see in our case what would be the profit. So if we know how much volume will be, what is the empty capacity on the truck that is going to depart in 1 week, we could sell all the empty space. So that our profit is everything that we sell. However, we incur a loss if the volume exceeds one truck. It means that we won't be able to get it on our truck, and we'll have to get a truck on the open market, which is usually more expensive. Get it in the last minute, which is again expensive. So that's the loss. And this actually creates a kind of a profit loss function. This is how I started thinking. What is the optimal bet, knowing that something about the future volume, even if we don't know the point estimate, but knowing, but something, I mean the distribution, the shape of the distribution, if you knew this, what would be the optimal bet in order to, how much to sell so that you rarely get this loss, but you collect this profit. And the idea is that one truck is a fixed cost that is quite expensive compared to this profit. I mean, I don't have exact numbers. Actually, as Peruch, our CEO, is better in the numbers with transport companies. And we played with different numbers. This is something we discussed with Agility themselves. The idea is that this fixed cost is quite large compared to the profit you get. Alternative is not to sell the volume, not to, by selling, I mean, you can just sell it on a discounted price so that you just get somebody to fill it. The truck is anyway going, so any money you get there, a profit. But the transportation company could actually use their other products, like, for example, in our case, it was, we were predicting shipments that are less of 2,500 kilos, and they have also other shipments that are larger than this, and if we could find some of them, we could get them on the same truck. But again, why then they don't do it today? It is because they should know this in advance. This is again prediction. Anyway, so we started looking at this like betting, and this is just an example. If it was a normal distribution. This is the distribution of the outcome. I mean, the distribution of the future weight, the empty space. If the empty space, they all have the same mean, but you can see that they have it's a different standard deviation. So although you expect, this number is, imagine it is not 6, but 600, for example, to be more. Imagine that there are 600 kilos available in either case, in the mean. If you have this case, however, you'd probably sell, you'd consider that it is not 600, but something like that, something like 300 or something like that, because your risk here is larger. Well, if you know that this is the case, you'd probably sell more, like 400 or something like that. So the idea is, in order to bet, you don't need just the mean. It's not enough to have the mean. It's on one side, you might have a vague prediction for the mean, but you need a shape of the distribution. It doesn't matter how ugly it is, as long as you know it. So, how we decided to do this? So we started, just to verify our approach, we started with just taking the history. I mean, you have so you have all the past to 2011, here's 2012. I draw the years separately because we started I think this was our test interval test set. So you can take all the weights here and just draw them and see what the shape of this distribution is. This is unconditional. I mean, it doesn't depend on anything, just on the past. And it appeared, even with this case, if you find some optimal value, you could have some improvement. I think we could capture about 20% or similar of the free capacity by just getting this distribution without involving anything. I mean, just saying, okay, this is the distribution of the, these are the possible weights from the past. So if you look at the future, probably it will be similar. That was the naive approach, and actually we didn't calculate. Probably if you approximate this to some known distribution like normal or sum of normals or something like that, you could solve it analytically, what is the optimal bet. You'll get something like, if I return to the profit and loss, it would be something like the probability of having I'll have to think about that, but something like the probability of empty capacity, the probability of sold plus forecasted mean. Being greater, so this is the probability of going beyond one truck. I might be a bit wrong here, but something like that. And so this is the loss, and you also have sold multiplied by the. Okay, say it. Price per kilo. So you get something like that. And if you have, if you know this this distribution here, I mean, if you know the distribution of the forecast, you would know this one, and you could analytically solve it. and as long as this probability is something that you can work with. This sounds okay, right? But we didn't do it that way. Instead, we did a kind of simulation for a various reasons. We are not sure about the shape of this one, although we had the past distribution. We did a kind of simulation and just tested all the values. So imagine this is a truck, and it goes from, for example, 100, 200, and this is 24. There are 24 of these numbers, and we try to see which of these is optimal. I mean, if you choose this one, and given this kind of distribution, if you draw some numbers from it, what would be the profit, what would be the loss, and what is the expected outcome. So we did this kind of Monte Carlo simulation. There are various reasons for this. One is that we are not sure about the shape, and another is different people are doing this. This is something that Nina and I could solve in R, that's the platform, while Asperuch was doing the all the modeling in Excel, and this is something he could do in Excel easily. So, but that was the approach to find the kind of optimal value. The optimal value would be just looking at all the profit samples. And we also tested this one. For this one, to test it, what we needed was, remember that we had all the shipments, although we were forecasting only these data below 2,500 kilos. And we had other data, and we just wanted to make sure that anytime we have some empty space left in the truck, we are able to find a shipment that is larger and that is not part of this product that could be loaded on this truck. We wanted this in order to be sure when we go to agility and say, okay, you can optimize your capacity by just using this kind of approach. And yeah, it appeared that almost in 90% there always was some other shipment that could be loaded. In some rare cases like holidays and so on, that they were not. Okay. But once we did this, it appeared it is useful to explore the idea more. This kind of idea to try to find the optimum bet by just using the probability, the distribution of the future weight. We decided to see whether we could estimate this distribution in a better way. And we tried this so-called hidden Markov model. Do you know what hidden Markov model is? That's good, right? Because I'm going to steal it. Okay. Just a couple of words before that. The hidden Markov model is very often used in speech recognition and handwriting recognition. It is very useful when you have some sequence of data. It's a Markov chain. I mean, the sequence is not necessary to be temporal. You just need to have some dependency between the previous and the next value. It's quite a useful algorithm. Maybe not even for our case, but in other areas. You can just Google for it and you'll find lots of examples. So, you know what Markov model is, Markov chain, right? In short, is this correct? I wrote it yesterday quite late in the evening, so I think that's it. But the idea is that you depend only on the previous state. You don't depend how you reach there.
The current state depends on the previous state. That's
Okay, here I wrote it like the future depends on the current and not on the past. Yeah, so I think that's a kind of formal definition. I mean, if you have this state, given all the states before that, is actually the same as given just the previous state. And in this case, you have initial probabilities and transition probabilities. Transition probability is the probability of going from state to state. However, Markov model has one great disadvantage, and it is that often when you have a system, you don't observe the state directly. You observe something about the state, you observe an evidence, something that is produced by the system in the given state, but you don't observe the state directly. And this is where the idea of hidden Markov model comes from. It is similar to a Markov model. This is again a Markov chain. But on each state, you have an observation that is emitted. It's an emission or observation. You can see different terminology and actually different notations. I use these ones because, okay, PI is often used as initial. Transition, I use T because of transition, and O because of observation. Sometimes you might see E, like epsilon, or you can see whatever. I mean, I'm not sure about the notation, so yeah, don't kill me if you find it in another way. So the idea here is, again, that you have states with all the transitions between states, but these are hidden. You don't know them. These are hidden or latent variables. They're not observable. What you observe are these values. And they might be continuous variables. That might be discrete variables. It's different. This also can be continuous and can be discrete. In our case, they were discrete, and it's easier to model them. And this diagram, by the way, is often called trellis. This is this kind of diagram. What are the properties? Again, it's very similar to a Markov model about the transition. But you also have the observations. And the idea here is that what gets emitted on a given state does not depend on previous states, neither on previous emissions. It depends only on the current state. All these attributes are quite important because they allow for efficient calculation of various stuff you'll see in a while. If we didn't have this one, in order to calculate a probability, you have to actually sum over all possible sequences of states. So these are hidden Markov model properties. Okay, how are they often represented? In our case, and not only, states are discrete variables. They're just values from 1 to n. Imagine that there are n states. And you have transition probabilities, a matrix n by n, where EG is actually the probability of getting from E to G, if this is the current state. Of course, each row of the matrix sums to 1, and I think this is called stochastic matrix or something like that. Sometimes you can see this swapped. I mean, it's the columns, not the rows. But anyway, that's the idea. Observations, in our case, they were continuous variables. And actually, they assumed some normal distribution. But they could be, again, discrete. And in this case, you have, for each variable, you have some numbers. But think of this is just a function. It's the probability distribution function of the variable when in state E. So you have, for each state, you have a different distribution of the observation in case it is continuous, random variable. So this is the representation that you often see. It might be different. It is possible that these are continuous, these are discrete, and so on. But yeah, this is how we used it. So these are the problems associated with hidden Markov model. Actually, if you look at the, I think in the very original paper, they're not these two, but the problem there is stated is given a observation sequence, like, so you have observed this sequence, what is the problem, and given the model itself with all the parameters, what is the probability of observing this sequence? That's I think is the classical problem instead of these two, but we'll see next time that the algorithm that calculates this one actually is used to calculate this also. They're related. I mean, it's the forward backward algorithm, and it actually calculates to some extent this stuff. So what's the problem here? Filtering. This is given a sequence and a model. Compute the distribution of the compute the last hidden state. The distribution, it means the possible values that it can take with all the probabilities. It's filtering because it's for the, so given a sequence, often you're interested in the last state, and you can do further calculations there. Okay, I can't explain exactly why it's called filtering, but at least for the smoothing. The smoothing is very similar, but it calculates the distributions here. And the idea of smoothing is, and here's how hidden Markov model is often used. You have a number of observations. However, as I said, these are not the actual states. These are just observations. And smoothing means to somehow find the true value that goes here. I mean, in each state, you have some state, some other hidden variable, but you don't know. But if you know the model parameters, actually, that's the also the third one, you can find what is the most likely sequence of states that produced this observation. For this one, you just find the distribution on each state, but actually this is the observation. Anyway, yeah. Is this clear enough so far? Okay. The last one, actually, which is the important here in our case, was if you don't know the model, how you can learn the parameters of the model? That's the question. I mean, you don't know the transition probabilities, you don't know the observation or emission probabilities, you don't know the initial, although I think the initial are usually assumed something, they're not estimated. And the idea is to estimate, and given a sequence of observations, to estimate the transition and the observation. So actually, you are given a sequence of observation, and you are given number of states. That's what I miss here, what I miss there. And it tries to find the best, in the context of, actually it is likelihood estimation, maximum likelihood estimation. It tries to find the best parameters that could generate given this number of states and this observation sequence. We'll see this next time. I'm not sure. I'll definitely talk a bit about that. Not sure whether I'll go into all the details of this algorithm. It's a Baum-Welch algorithm, but it uses expectation maximization approach. Not sure how familiar you are with this. I think there is also a solution that is based on another approach, like gradient descent or something like that. If I find this, I'll talk more about that. But I'll touch it definitely. About this one, there is a so-called Viterbi algorithm. I'll talk about that. And this, as I said, this is a forward-backward algorithm. That is, it's a good example of so-called dynamic programming. And dynamic programming is not programming. And I'm not sure whether it is dynamic at all. But that's the name. I think I read in Wikipedia that the story behind dynamic programming was that maybe Richard Bellman, or I might be wrong, but the story was that the guy was doing some optimization and he was asked to find a name that he could present to big bosses or something like that. And he just came with that name because it sounds clever, something like that. But
may I ask words, as an old person, the term programming instead of optimization appeared well before computers. That's why mathematical programming was the term used for operation research problems for many years. After that, it started combined with computer programming, which is all of you know what this means. But this term still exists in literature and many methods use the term programming for solving optimization problems, which is typical the part of operation research area.
Yeah, that's. And the forward backward algorithm, it's not a complex, it's quite simple, I would say, but it allows us to really efficiently calculate this one. I mean, calculate the probability of a given sequence if you know the parameters. Otherwise, imagine the complexity of algorithm that was doing the naive approach. It would be something like, okay, I'm trying to get it right now. It would be something like you sum over all possible sequences of states, combination of states, and you get here something like the probability of the first state. Multiplied by the emission of first state, multiplied by the transition between S1 and S2, multiplied by emission of, and so on. But all of these, if you have, for example, n possible states, the complexity of this one would be M to N, right? These sequences, which is it is the sum that's important here. I might be slightly wrong here, but I think that's it. But this is even if you have a sequence of, it is because the length of the sequence is in the power. If you have a 1,000, in our case we had, for example, 2 years, that was 700 days. Okay, even if they're just only weeks, 100 weeks, you will have here 100, and if you have three states here, it will be three on the 100. But definitely, you should intuitively understand that there should be a better approach just because, remember that property. Obviously, it should be something better just because if you know, if you have estimated everything here, this transition does not depend on nothing here. So there should be something easy to, should be a better approach to estimate what is here. Just because of this Markov property. This one depends only on what is at the end, not how you came there. That's the intuition, and yeah, this is the forward backward algorithm, but I'll talk in more details next week. Okay. So, what we did in our case, our idea was we decided, so remember that the naive approach was estimating the probability distribution just by taking the history and that's it. That, think of this as a kind of unconditional distribution. And but while dealing with other algorithms like association rules and decision trees, we are wondering there is there any relationship between what is the state currently? I mean, if there is no volume today, will be there more volume next week or something like that? So we wanted here to condition on the current week and see what would be the distribution next week. And actually, we are currently doing this on aggregated volume. I mean, all the shippers on the same trade lane. And it works to some extent, but our belief is this model will probably work better if we do it on individual level for each particular shipper. Because somehow this idea, if a shipper ships a lot this week, probably will ship more or less next week, is somehow, we think, we haven't proved that, that it is, it makes more sense when you have a individual shipper. Imagine some process that generates shipments, either manufacturing or something like that. And it usually, in ideal world, it would have same rate. I mean, producing same volume of shipments each week. But sometimes something happens and you have more shipment, you just something gets delayed, for example, and you have less shipments, but then you have more shipments after several weeks, something like that. We believe that on an individual level, that that approach would be much better. And it is still a kind of open item in front of us. But what we did, there are three states. The idea was here that if you have something like that, this would be average, this would be low, this would be high volume. And the idea is by having these three states, see what estimate also. So these are the states. But you estimate the weight, the distribution of the weight in each state. That's what Hidden Markov model does. So apart from, actually the package that we used, apart from estimating these probabilities, this package also estimated the mean and the standard deviation of the, assuming that these are normally distributed. This package also estimated that that stuff. And yeah, this is what we estimated. So once we estimate the model parameters, we had this discussion until this morning with Nina. Currently, we take next state to be, so we estimate the parameters and we estimate the current what we know so far. And currently, what we do is we take the most likely state, the state that with highest probability based on the transition matrix. And given this state, it has some distribution here of the observation. So that's the next distribution. Our discussion with Nina was that we should probably not do this that way, but we have to sum here. I mean, if you have a 50% chance to go to state low, 30% to go to high, 20% to go to mean, we should probably sum this by the distribution here, distribution here, and distribution here. Actually, I thought until this morning, I thought that we're doing this way. But I talked with Nina, I wanted to verify it, and it appeared we're just taking the most probable path. But in either case, we get a distribution of the future weight. And then we go to the same approach that we did here in order to find if that's the distribution, what is the optimal bet. And what was interesting, the improvement over the previous approach of that we had with historical shipments, the improvement was not so big in terms of revenue that we get, but we managed to avoid most of the time losses. I mean, we bet more safely, I would say it that way. And this is good. Even if you make the same amount of money, if we tell the so when we talk, when we, you should know this. I don't know whether you studied any finance or something like that. But if you get the same reward out of two approaches or out of two funds or something like that, same income, you should see. You should measure also the risk that caused that that allowed this gain to happen. So if you have, there's even a ratio, I think, in financial world that is the profit divided by the standard deviation of the of that. The idea is that you should get the same profit with less risk. This is also a very important improvement. So we managed to do this. I mean, the profit we had was not, it was better, but not not quite better. But the risk was really lower. And we just did it in a safer way. So that was the result.
That's a good result.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, there were lots of assumptions here. As I said, all of these costs was somehow based on Asparuch's understanding. They are to some extent correct. I mean, at least in the magnitude and so on. But there are lots of. What is also important is that this is highly theoretical model. Where we are, and once we start. Working really, so this project was kind of to prove our concept, to build some theoretical models in order to prove our concept and see whether there is really an improvement, there is really a possibility to have an improvement in this empty capacity that we started with. And we think we prove it, that there is a way to improve a lot. There is not only the opportunity, but it is really possible to improve a lot. When we start working in reality, probably there will be lots of details that we need to polish, and that could make all of this invalid. But there will be, how to say it, the devil is in the details, you know that. For example, we are talking about loss here, but loss is not only money. I mean, if you're losing constantly, it has also psychological effect. It is very hard to convince people that in the longer term they will succeed. I mean, that would not work. So this is also why the idea of getting less risk was very important. I mean, there's also something that you cannot measure here. If you delay a shipment for an important customer several times, the important customer, if it is a large customer, might just stop working with you. And you can't calculate this here. So there are lots of details. So this is highly theoretically, but we proved that we knew there is a room for optimization, and we proved that it is possible to be achieved. And yeah, I think that's my presentation for today. This one was a bit shorter. By the way, one interesting topic, I recalled myself this yesterday, but forgot to mention here, is how you estimate error, how you estimate the accuracy of the forecast. It was a very long discussion between us. We know that, for example, in linear regression, you try to minimize the sum of squares. For various algorithms, you see various information criteria, whether all the information is included or not, and so on. But all of these are useful while playing with the models, and they're useful to debug them and see how to improve them, and so on. But at the end, they're very hard to present them to clients. I mean, even sum of squares is something we could not go to agility and say, okay, this approach is best because this sum of squares is the minimum here. What DHL are doing, this is how they're reporting it, and after lots of discussions, they just, it's some of the, so you have an error for each prediction. So that's the actual, that's the forecast, actual forecast. And you have every day, for every prediction, you have an error. And so they just decided that it is sum of the error divided by the sum of the actual. On the other side, this was good to present because they say, okay, we have, for example, 15% error. And it makes sense. I mean, when the big manager or big boss say, what is this 15%? Well, that's the total volume that we got there. I mean, in total, you had, okay, and this is actually, this error is absolute error, of course. I mean, it's not negative and positive, so they do not. So this is something they, it's easy to present, but in our case with agility, this one was not very good because we were getting lots of bad numbers. I mean, there are some uneven trade lanes where you have lots of zeros, and at the end you get quite a big number here, but yeah, that's the reality. But anyway, this is also something you should consider. How you estimate error, and the theory says that the theory usually advises what kind of criteria to use in this algorithm or this algorithm or this algorithm. For example, for classification, you say the number of classes or the number of examples that you misclassified, or you have some cost function, cost matrix, where you have these true positives, false positives, true negatives, false negatives, and so on. You might have different weights. All of these are correct ways to measure error, but at the very end you might end up with the question how to present error to people that are giving you money, and you should think about that also. Anyway, this was a kind of unusual. It makes sense, but it doesn't give you. I mean, some trade lanes are larger than others, you may get totally wrong on some trade lanes, but because they are smaller, you'll not get it that way because it sums all the stuff there. But yeah, this is an example where the reality is different than.
Okay, that's another dimension you have to think, which is very important in the real world. How to present to the client.
Yeah, after all the data analysis you do is supposed to have some impact on some real business or real situation or whatever. And, I mean, the idea is to get it out of the mathematics and get it into the real world. It doesn't mean mathematics is not useful. Actually, it's very, very useful. It is a must here. Any questions?
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
This program is brought to you by AUBG Talks. For more, please visit us at aubg.edu/talks.